Paper was like gold in medieval times.
Oh, not tobacco. Sugar.
That everything we thought we knew about the world might turn out to be completely wrong.
We see Saudi Arabia as the country of oil and strict Islam, where women wear veils and kisses are edited out from films. But suddenly, there was a new crown prince. He says he wants to reform the country, women get more rights, and tourists will soon be welcome. The country has become less dependent on oil. At the same time, the people are ruled with an iron fist. One wrong word can have serious consequences. In this year of changes, I travel around the country and follow the developments on the inside through the eyes of the citizens. Are they just empty promises? Or is Saudi Arabia really able to change? The pride of Saudi Arabia is the Arabian horse. It is fast, nimble, and it has a lot of stamina. The Saudis admire this animal to no end.
Nou, het is echt een prachtig dier. Fantastisch. En die bewondering, dat gaat eigenlijk best wel ver terug. Dat was met de Bedouinen in dit land die dit paard verder hebben ontwikkeld. Dat was Abdulaziz Al Saud, die op zijn Arabische paard met zijn mannen Riyadh binnenviel. En uiteindelijk dus de macht in dit land ook greep. En hij bouwde het Koninkrijk van Saudi-Arabië op.
تتبادل انت وياه الاحساس ف زي ما تقول ما نقول حب نعدي درجه الحب نقول اخذ مرحله الشغف
هذا شهاد رمز السعودي
والله شيء اكيد انه بيكون رمز للدوله السعوديه لان والدنا ووحدت الجزيره العربيه بفضل الله ثم بفضل الملك عبد العزيز العربيه فاعتقد ان رمز رمز رمز
الهسان مصدر فحرك
نعم موجودة الفرس أجده
ممكن نشوف هذا الهسان
تفضل يلا مشينا
beautiful ميام yeah very very nice كيف أصبح قدا جميل؟
الخيل بصفة عامة عشان تثبت جماليته يعني مقسمة على خمس أشياء اللي هو الرأس العنق الجسم الحركة الشخصية العربية شخصية يعني الخيل العربية عنده شخصية عنده هوية عربية لما أشوف الشخص هذا أقول هذا عربي أو هذا أوروبي نفس الخيل الخيل برضو فيها الشيء هذا فيها الجاذبية هذه كلها لها تقييمة وتقييمة يعني يرفع معدل الجمال فيها جمعها لنا بالفحل هذا بسم الله عليه ما شاء الله يعني يعد من أجمل الخيول العربية
This horse has always been linked to the country's rich and powerful. Many of them have their own thoroughbred Arabian horse. Every year they gather at the largest horse festival in eastern Saudi Arabia. This is a party for the elite.
Nou, als je rijkdom in Saudi Arabië wil zien, dan is dit echt de plek. Hier komt het geld bij elkaar. Nou, dat zijn goed mannen die zijn ingehuurd om die paarden op te zwepen. Het zijn nogal gepassioneerde paarden. Een beetje onstuimig ook af en toe. En dat willen ze graag zien. Er hangt ook nog prijzengeld aan vast. Maar het gaat vooral om de eer, namelijk wie heeft het mooiste paard van Saudi-Arabië.
Dat is gewoon iets wat zeker. Zoals we een misverkiezing hebben, is dat hier voor de paarden. Maar altijd al bestaan voor alle rassen hoor. Exterieurkeuring, zo noem ik het.
Dat heet zo. Correct. Ja. Zo'n toppaard, hè? Wat kost dat eigenlijk?
Een werkelijk toppaard, een witte raaf. $3 miljoen, $4 miljoen dollar.
Maar wie kan er eigenlijk zo'n paard betalen? Ik bedoel echt het topsegment.
Ah, topsegment, ja, er zijn enkel de paar chains die ze kunnen veroorloven.
Er is straks in de koningsklasse paarden die 10 jaar en ouder zijn. Wie is voor u een van de kanshebbers?
Wel, een van de kanshebbers is misschien wel de prins met een van zijn paarden. Die kans zit er dik in.
Security is taken up a few notches, awaiting the arrival of Prince Bin Nayef. He was once regarded as the crown prince. He wants to win, and if he doesn't, he will simply buy the horse that won.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to announce the medal-winning mares.
A very, very exciting and interesting competition. They were all above the 90-point mark.
No one knows how many princes there are exactly. It is estimated that there are several thousand.
Waarschijnlijk is het zijn eigen paard.
The House of Saud reigns supreme. Many of the most important jobs are assigned to family members. Prince Bin Nayef is governor of the Eastern Province.
Bijna een soort heiligheid in dit land gewoon. Want hij wordt echt helemaal afgedekt. 50 man aan bodyguards heeft hij. Nou, dit is dus typisch het huis van Saud. Onaantastbaar, onschendbaar, maar ook onbereikbaar.
Questions are not allowed. The royal family's word is law in this country. They have a firm grip on the most important source of income, oil. Gigantic amounts of it had been found by Western geologists under the Arabian Peninsula's desert plains.
Ja, dit is dus Aramco, het grootste oliebedrijf van de wereld. En ik zit in een Aramco-auto, want die kan niet zomaar het terrein op hier. Het is gewoon een hele... Eigenlijk gewoon een hele stad in een stad.
So can we go closer?
Of course, please. This is the first oil well in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia.
The first place where they found oil.
Oil, correct.
This is the really first place.
Yes, correct.
Yeah?
They actually started by drilling 10 wells at that time, 1933. So they drilled well number one, number two, three. For number one, they find just gas and some water. Mm-hmm. Number two, no oil. They were totally disappointed.
Unlike their neighboring countries, the disappointed Saudis didn't find any oil. But a stubborn American geologist called Max Steinecke kept searching. His idea was to drill deeper.
So Max, he decided just randomly to come back to well number seven, and then he drilled deeper up to like 1,441 meters.
Wow.
Then the oil started to struck.
So the history could be different for us if we were the one who found the oil, but it was the Americans.
It was the Americans, and that's where we had the concession agreement with the American geologists. And that's where they named the Aramco company Aramco, which came from Arabian American Oil Company. Since they're the one who discovered the oil, so it was like 50% investment. 50,
and now?
50. No, now it's been Saudi.
Totally Saudi?
Totally Saudi.
And where does the revenue of Aramco go?
It's government-owned country, company.
Also to the royal house?
Yes, of course, because it's government-owned. Correct.
I see that Alina is taken aback. She just admitted that a lot of the oil revenues flow to the royal family. How much is a secret? Aramco is the most profitable company in the world. It is worth almost $2 trillion. The oil discovery also meant that more Westerners entered the country. They took up residence behind the closed doors of Aramco, together with Saudi employees.
How long do you work for Aramco?
For Aramco now 20 years.
On the compound?
I used to, but I moved out. Yes, I used to. I like it there because it's more convenient for me. I have my car, I'm driving, moving around, so that was a good thing.
So you're driving a car on the compound?
Oh, yes, yeah? Of course.
And outside the compound?
No.
So the life inside the compound is different as outside the compound?
Absolutely. We call it the Little America, because we have all the facilities, even the greens, the plants, the gardens, the houses are built like in American style, so women can drive. So it's absolutely Little America.
But to be honest, I traveled in Saudi Arabia now for weeks. You are the first one, first female, that tells me that she's working for 20 years.
Because it was Arabian American Oil Company, and at that time we hired so many Americans. A large number of Americans, females and males, of course. So, and that is the big influence.
So Aramco had a role in the emancipation of Saudi women.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes, of course. And we were proud of that.
Alina is quite frank, and so she's no longer allowed to guide us. For years, a veil of secrecy has hung over the compound. Many Saudis consider this place to be depraved. Men and women mingled freely here. The strictly Islamic society took offense at this. We have to hide our camera.
Dit ziet er allemaal heel goed uit, goed georganiseerd ook. Man en vrouw door elkaar, maar ook allerlei mooie voorzieningen voor kinderen. Ook een bioscoop hier achter me, cafeetjes, restaurantjes. Het is eigenlijk een heel andere wereld hier. En ondertussen moet ik ook even goed om me heen kijken dat er geen mensen van de beveiliging zijn die ons misschien staande kunnen houden hier. De Saudische staat die ziet het eigenlijk helemaal niet zitten dat wij hier filmen. En dat heeft te maken met dat er hier toch een ander leven is dan buiten de muren van dit bedrijf.
From 1933 onwards, the Americans were involved with the oil extraction. This enabled the countries to strike a wonderful deal when they needed each other most.
Nou, bitter leek wat daar ligt, daar verderop. Daar werd in 1945 een cruciale overeenkomst gesloten. Op een marineschip tussen de Amerikaanse president Roosevelt en de Saoedische koning Abdulaziz. En die overeenkomst, dat is eigenlijk een scharnierpunt in de geschiedenis van Saudi-Arabië. En ik denk in de wereldgeschiedenis.
After 1945, America needed lots of oil. Saudi Arabia was able to deliver it, and the country's founder, King Abdulaziz, saw it as an opportunity to spread his faith. The Saudis agreed to exchange oil for money, but they would decide how it was spent.
It's the annual classic car show we do every year. It's a gathering for people to enjoy the cars, to enjoy the beautiful designs of the 50s and 40s classic cars.
And do Saudis like cars?
Yeah, they love cars. Mm-hmm. We used to buy pickups so we can carry stuff, sheep, camels and people in the pickup.
Because you didn't find oil yet then?
Yeah, no, the oil was found in Saudi Arabia from the 30s, but it was not as much as today. So thanks God for all what we have. Alhamdulillah.
The discovery of oil led to an abundant supply of money, and most of it ended up here, in Diriyah, a town near Riyadh. Ever since the founding of Saudi Arabia, this is where power and faith converge.
I heard that also some cars are from the royal family.
Yeah.
That's true?
Yes. King Salman, to support the youth and the show, he accepted to present four of his personal cars that he used to drive in the 70s.
Is it possible to buy a car from a royal family?
It's possible, but it's rare, so it's expensive.
So this is for the rich Saudis?
Depends how do you find rich. Mm-hmm. Maybe you say if you have 1 million, you are rich, but for me, maybe $100 million is a rich guy.
What is rich for you?
100 million. قالوا نبي نصور مع واحد مليونير. قلت اجيب لكم مليونير.
We are lucky. Sattam, the organizer of the auto show, sees one of the truly wealthy walk by. Prince Saud bin Turki Al Saud.
You're from the royal family?
Yeah.
So are you going to buy a car at the auction?
Maybe, why not?
Maybe?
Maybe, yeah.
Which one?
The red one.
The red one, yeah?
If he likes the red one, he's rich.
How many princes there are in Saudi Arabia?
Maybe 4 or 3, 5 thousand.
4 or 3, 5 thousand. Yeah. Wow, that's a lot of princes,
yeah.
Eh?
Yeah.
You know them all also?
Yes, I know
everybody.
Not in particular, but I know them all.
Can I ask you another question?
Yeah.
In the family, you are also speaking about the changes. How is that inside the family?
Everybody's happy about it.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Everybody supports also?
Yes, we support 200% everything.
You
can excuse me because my son is waiting.
Oh, sorry, I'm sorry, sorry. No
the prince is extremely friendly, but as soon as we talk about the reforms, he has to go. And he doesn't want to talk to me later on either. I feel that we need to be careful. King Salman's car hasn't been sold. His palace is nearby. Fortunately, Sattam allows me to get in. He's willing to bring me closer. He knows the town inside out.
So we are royal now with the red carpet. We are famous. I'm from Diriyah. My grandfather is from Diriyah. And also, I'm with the prince of Diriyah, is a close friend. Hello, عم. مستمتعين بالتوفيق إن شاء الله. آمين آمين.
We see King Salman's country house rise up in the distance. One of the locals I met at the auto show is willing to bring me closer to the palace. Only later do I find out how powerful Mansur al-Shahoub is.
أسرتنا مرتبطة بالأسرة آل سعود من عبر التاريخ. قصر طويل العمر الله يطول عمره ويخليه. كينج سلمان. قصر العوجة.
He's there now, King Salman?
Yeah.
Coming from Saudi Arabia. It's huge, eh? Big, kabir.
Hey.
Huh?
Naam. نعم أسرة آل سعود بدأت الحكم الدولة السعودية الأولى بدأت من هنا.
Dat is best grappig. Dus het paleis van de huidige koning Salman zit rechts, zeg maar. En het paleis van de oude koning, van de eerste koning Saud, aan de andere zijde van de stad. Dit is dus ook echt de stad waar het allemaal is begonnen hier. So this is the most important city in Saudi Arabia then?
هذه أهم مدينة. أهم مدينة في, في, في لأنها هي بداية التأسيس. هي لأنها هي العاصمة الأولى. وسور الدرعية كما تعرفون ويعرف الجميع أن سور الدرعية حصار الدرعية هذا جزء منه السور التاريخي
السور التاريخي؟
نعم هذا السور كان محاوط للدرعية ككل هذا جزء منه
Not only is this small city the birthplace of the House of Saud but it is also here that in the 18th century the alliance was forged between Muhammad ibn Saud and religious leader Sheikh Abdul al-Wahhab. This alliance found massive support and led to the Saudi Arabia of today. The royal house of Saud rose to power thanks to Wahhabism, the ultra-orthodox Islamic doctrine as state religion.
So that was the palace of King Saud, but what about al-Wahhab?
هذا مسجد الشيخ محمد عبد الوهاب وهذا وسكنه نعم وهذا مسجده كان في الوادي هذا الوادي وكان على الوادي
سلام
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله كيف حالك
ولم يكن هناك
حياكم الله يا اخوان اهلا وسهلا كيف حالكم
To my surprise we are right next to the mosque Mansour is the head of an important family in Diriyya. Without asking permission, he takes me to the mosque of Abdul al-Wahhab, the religious reformer who introduced Wahhabism 3 centuries ago. He said that those who didn't follow the true faith could even be fought with violence.
It ziet er wel heel nieuw uit, moet ik zeggen.
These ideas inspired groups like Al-Qaeda and ISIS to spread death and destruction.
كما تشاهد الآن هذا مسجد الشيخ محمد عبد الوهاب بعد بنائه جميع الفروض تؤدى فيه.
So there are some groups who are using his ideology to use violence. They call him an extremist. What do you think about that?
غير صحيح الشيخ محمد عبد الوهاب درسنا كتبه وطلعنا على كتبه وذا لم يدعو في يوم من الأيام لنوع شيء اسمه الجهاد أو الإرهاب أو ما يسمى أنه إرهاب أو كذا غير صحيح إلى مسكنه إلى مسجده إلى موقعه كله كلام هذا مركب تركيب هو فقط إمام مثل أمة الآخرين
My visit to the mosque reveals a sore spot. The ideology that has been exported using oil money leading to violence in other places has its origins here. Mansour wants to rectify this image.
تلاحظون الآن هل رأيت كتب؟ هل رأيت شيء للشيخ محمد عبد الوهاب؟ هل رأيت شيء ما يغير؟ اللهم كلها مصاحف وقرآن قرآن صغير وكبير كما ترون مصاحف لا يوجد هناك كما يدعي الغرب أن الشيخ محمد عبد الوهاب أمر أو طلب كتبه أو تدرس أو كذا
Wat het voor mij dan nog verrassend maakt, is dus dat een local uit Diriyya tegen mij zegt, ja, maar dat hele gedachtegoed van hem is verkeerd uitgelegd. Maar als ik dan zie wat voor ellende het heeft veroorzaakt in al die landen waar ik ben geweest, Libië, Syrië, Irak, Afghanistan, kijk hoe vredig het hier is en hoe het dus elders wat voor ellende het heeft veroorzaakt. En dat allemaal is begonnen hier op deze plek waar die man is geboren en waar hij zijn gedachtegoed heeft verspreid over de hele wereld. Dat is toch bizar.
The brewing fundamentalism that was embraced by many Saudis first damaged the House of Saud itself. As a protest against foreign influences and women's rights, such as Aramco's Little America, the unfathomable happens. Mecca, the Saudi holy place, is attacked by a handful of extremists in 1979. I traveled to Jeddah to talk to an editor-in-chief who saw it happen up close and isn't afraid to talk about it.
It was a game changer. There was a creeping tide of extremism had come in.
But how did it change? Because how was it before and how was it after?
Before we were normal people. I saw all the James Bond movies in Saudi Arabia, in Jeddah, with my mother in the 70s and early 80s. It was totally different before the Sahara came, the awakening came.
The Saudi king was shocked. His power rested on the alliance with religious leaders, but resistance had grown. The attackers were executed and he had a solution to prevent further uprisings. Wahhabism needed to be followed more strictly. This was called the awakening.
So this Sahwa, the awakening that came in 30 years, was really disastrous for the Arab. Yeah.
And then the attack came and then everything changed.
Yes.
And what was the first thing that changed?
I mean, the relegation of women in the background, the mosques used to come and say things wrong, things that were totally alien. I mean, things that didn't even concern us, covering the faces, hellfire, brimstone, born again Muslims.
The bad thing on that attack is that the aggressor won. He wanted something that the country gets more conservative.
Yes.
And he succeeded in that.
So he lost the battle, but won the war. It brought in dark clouds. I think it was hijacked by preachers.
From then on, religious conservatism had an even tighter grip on Saudi Arabia. Women were forced to cover their faces. Cinemas were closed, while the doors opened for extremism.
We have supported many organizations here and there. There, of course, there are issues, the issue of extremism, the attack on the haram, the rising tide of intolerance. Yes, we admit we made a mistake. And then even the Crown Prince said that we made a mistake. And that caused all these problems. Yeah.
The extremism reached its apogee during the September 11 attacks. Not far from the editor-in-chief's office is the birthplace of the man who changed the world.
Is this official Bin Laden Road?
Yeah. This is Bin Laden Road.
Ja, de Bin Laden die de wereld kent is natuurlijk Osama Bin Laden. Misschien wel de bekendste Saudiër ooit. Dit is de wijk waar hij is geboren, is opgegroeid. Hij komt uit een grote familie.
Bin Laden's father made his money constructing roads. He was closely tied to the Saudi royal family. After oil was discovered, he was assigned large construction projects. We aren't allowed to film here either.
Deze hele wijk was dus in handen van de familie van Bin Laden. Gewoon echt een deel van de stad Jeddah. En deze weg is dus vernoemd naar de familienaam Bin Laden. Hier, dit hele complex. Het huis staat er nog. En je ziet licht oranje kleurig gebouw. Hier is hij dus opgegroeid. En er wonen nog familieleden, maar die worden afgeschermd.
This is
let me walk here.
Walk?
Walk.
Stop here?
Yeah.
This mosque contributed to his radicalization and is closed now. But the effect of the sermons here has changed the way the world views Saudi Arabia forever. Now that the country appears to be opening up, I am invited by Mansour and his son Salah to visit their home. They want to distance themselves from the extremism.
على ابدا وسطي ولا نعرف هذا الاشياء اللي يقال عنها الارهاب والجهاد لا نعرف هذه الاشياء ولم نعرفها الا في العشر سنوات الاخيره هذه اللي سمعنا فيها.
Of course we had all the attacks and all the world, they don't know, of course they will link the terrorism with us, which is wrong,
but there is a strict form of the Islam in Saudi Arabia. You agree on that?
We had some conservative periods, but that doesn't mean that we accept the terrorism or the jihadis or any part of those of that ideology.
But 9/11, it made a very bad image of Saudi Arabia.
Of course, that affect us, and the first people who got hurt are us, and the attacks of them in Saudi Arabia, and we lived it, and we were scared out of it, and we hated it. Was in Saudi Arabia more than 60 or 70 attack in Saudi Arabia, and it was bloody ugly thing that no human can accept ever.
Mohammed bin Salman slams the door in the face of extremism. He says he wants to return to moderate Islam of before 1979. This makes him popular among young people.
نحن فقط نعود إلى ما كنا عليه. الإسلام الوسطي المعتدل المنفتح على العالم وبكل صراحة لن نضيع.
The good thing about His Royal Highness, he's we studied at the same school, by the way.
Yeah. Do you know him also? Yeah. Personal?
Yes, personal. When we were young, we lived a normal life that the young population lived, and he heard their needs, and he was one of them. Now as a leader, he's taking us to what is called a future.
It is Friday. The family, and thus the elite of Saudi Arabia, gathers. I am asked to stay and eat with them. The guests are surprised to see me.
Nice to meet you too.
Salah, who are these people? Is it all family?
No, not all of them are family. We have like architects, engineers, generals.
How important is this for the Saudi people?
You find it in all the families. It's very important if anyone needs anything from the other, so they can help each other. And
this is the real Daraya.
My grandfather now, he was one with the king, late King Abdulaziz. Yeah, his name Muhammad. So the family has a very close tie. They served the country for a long, long, long time.
So then I understand the loyalty of you and the people to the kingdom.
Our parents, our grandparents, they're passing this loyalty to us, and we're going to carry on to my son and so forth.
This is the protective ring around the royal family. They are most loyal. The question is whether it is possible to criticize the royal family.
Like critics on the royal family, is that possible?
Well, yeah. Yeah.
Openly,
yes.
Without getting any penalty?
No. If a critic is within the boundaries of respect, fine. But you don't go and start shouting and bluffing or saying lies, and they will let you go.
And if you do that?
If you do that,
you get penalty.
They should be penalized. If somebody who's not respecting the king or the laws and everything, he should not be respected.
You might get me in trouble now, huh?
Off camera, there is clearly a fear to say something wrong, even among the elite. Salah takes me to the place where there are women. He'd rather show me the image of the new Saudi Arabia.
All of this is paid by the government. We have the Entertainment Authority. Uh-huh. It's a new authority started by...
It calls the Entertainment Authority?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. And they are planning to make 5,500 events like this.
It's very crowded here.
Eh? Yeah, it's very crowded. And you see all the kind of the community, the old and the young, girls, ladies, and children.
But a lot of girls.
Yeah. They're happy to be here and to have this opportunity with them.
What happened with Saudi Arabia?
Well, we have the great Crown Prince, and he's doing a very great job supporting the young population.
So people are ready for change?
Yeah, they are happy, and he's an idol.
And does the Crown Prince also work on better human rights for Saudi Arabia?
Yes, he's promised with a good, better, and he's doing very well. What he did in 2 years, it take another country's 100 years to change it this fast.
For Salah, the Crown Prince is a synonym for change. The government supports young people financially to start small companies. This only increases the faith in reforms.
Is this the new energy in Saudi Arabia?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes. Because, you know, 70% of Saudi population, they are under 30 years old.
Very young population.
Very young, and they all have this energy to work, and they have energy to produce things.
So nobody can stop the changes.
Yes, no one can stop the change.
Prince Mohammed bin Salman won't stop.
Yes,
he will make it go further, I'm sure.
Yes. This is my country. I can't leave it. I have to fight for it.
Young people are fighting for the reforms. But this is made much harder due to events surrounding the Crown Prince. On the 2nd of October 2018, journalist Jamal Khashoggi is murdered in the Saudi consulate in Istanbul. Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman is suspected of giving the order, but the royal family denies it. As the news is reported, I try to gauge public opinion in Saudi Arabia itself.
Het valt niet mee om een krant te kopen hier, maar...
When mumkin Nesrin Jerida?
بعد المدرسة؟
Ja.
في مكتبة؟
في مكتبة؟
هاي في مكتبة
جديدة. شكرا.
عفوا. أهلا وسهلا.
Ze doen wel erg hun best om het imago op te krikken, maar ja, het werkt natuurlijk niet als je een Saudische journalist laat vermoorden. En het is echt een ontzettend gevoelig onderwerp hier. Nou, eindelijk een krantenkiosk gevonden. Salam alaikum. Marhaba. Kif hal? Al-Jarida al-Yum?
Ha?
Al-Yum?
Al-Yum, ja.
Khabar al-Sahafi?
Hij شوف كله مكتوب شوف كله حق اليوم جرايد. ما نعرف ايش اللي فيه.
Nou, de man zegt dus dat hij niet kan lezen. Wat natuurlijk een beetje lachwekkend is als je een boekwinkel hebt. Maar het is eigenlijk gewoon een smoes om niet te praten over wat het nieuws nu beheert in Saudi-Arabië. Dit zijn twee grote kranten in Saudi-Arabië. Maar echt bizar, de hele wereld heeft het erover, over die verdwijning. En allebei openen de krant met een foto van de koning. En een fijn gesprek met Trump. En dat Trump Saudi-Arabië steunt. Je zou zeggen van, nou, er staat een kritisch stuk over waarom maar 15 ambtenaren vanuit Saudi-Arabië naar Istanbul zijn vertrokken. Er is ook een arts meegegaan. Waarom? Dit zegt genoeg over persvrijheid in dit land. Je zou natuurlijk gek zijn om een heel kritisch artikel te schrijven over verdwijning van die journalist. Want Het zou zomaar kunnen dat jij dan zelf ook verdwijnt.
It is not easy to survive for journalists in this country. Often it is simply safest to remain silent. But Khalid Al-Mayena, Khashoggi's editor-in-chief for 12 years, is willing to take the risk and talks.
I was looking to Saudi newspapers. It was all the same headlines with the same picture.
See, every newspaper depends on its own editors. Mm-hmm. There are those who want to, and there are those not. Today in the Arab News, Faisal Abbas mm-hmm. wrote a beautiful article saying that, after this sad incident, things have to change. So I think it's important to have real journalists, yeah. people who care more for society, because journalism is not an easy thing.
No. It's a very dangerous job yes. also. What happened is also acknowledgement about that there is no press freedom. What happened with this journalist?
No, it was, I'll be the first to tell you mm-hmm. that it was a total, not error, it was a mm-hmm. calumny, it mm-hmm. was a crime and all, and the government has accepted the fact. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of these things happen. Nobody's condoning. Mm-hmm. I'm the last person, because it could have been anyone, but these things should never happen again. I mean, this has happened, unfortunately.
Yeah, but this journalist couldn't work in Saudi Arabia and flew abroad. Because he said, I couldn't work yes. here in yes. Saudi Arabia.
I was you know his also. Boss for 12 years. He had several issues. Mm-hmm. I applaud him for this. But then he did went and all, and he said that he could not for fear of being taken aside.
But you agree with me that things, happenings like this, it doesn't make Saudi Arabia's image in the West not very good.
It doesn't make the image look good here.
Yeah.
You think that the people here approved of this? Believe me, I am sure that the people who did this, and I pray to God that the people who did this will be taken to task,
right.
It will be made public, and there should be no stone unturned to find out the motives of the killers and who were the killers.
The editor-in-chief carefully weighs his words. He knows about the accusations against Mohammed bin Salman.
Is it possible to criticize MBS or his policy?
There's a way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
There's a way to do it. I mean, I have even been writing about the sponsorship system, which I think it was, and I wrote it in slavery. Mm-hmm. In Mecca newspaper, I wrote in the Gazette and all. Nothing happened to me. Today, if there are elections, he will win hands down.
Mm-hmm.
Believe me, I will vote for him, not for somebody else. We don't want somebody who's archaic person. We don't want somebody who will take us backwards.
Even Khashoggi's former editor-in-chief draws a line at the royal family. Criticism is fine, as long as it isn't directed towards Mohammed bin Salman. Not just out of fear of retaliation, but also the fear of returning to the old Saudi Arabia. The only thing left to do is to attend this first mixed screening with Saleh. He tries to be proud of what has been achieved so far, but he knows his beloved crown prince has shown the world another side of him. Next week, I follow the pilgrim's trail all the way to the Holy Kaaba in Mecca.
So God has given the power to Saudi Arabia.
I think it is a gift from God.
There is a call for moderate Islam, but do religious leaders support it?